Welcome to our Zoom interview at the National Museum of the U.S. Air Force with Kathleen Cosand, one of the first female pilots in the U.S. Air Force and the very first female pilot in the reserves. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Perfect. We'll go ahead and get started. What inspired you to join the Air Force?
John Glenn. When I was 7 years old, I was in a dentist office and I saw John Glenn being shot up into space. And I decided I wanted to fly airplanes. I thought in the mid 70s, things were changing. And my thought process was, well, the Air Force, obviously, because it has more planes than anybody else does, and that's their primary mission, they will be the first service that will open up for women to go fly. So I'm going to go join the Air Force and I'm going to go fly airplanes in the Air Force. Of course, I was wrong because the Navy started before that and then the Army started. But my timing wouldn't have changed anyhow because I didn't graduate till 76.
What did your family think about your choice to join the military and specifically aviation?
Well, I come from a long history pretty much of military people. My dad was a supply sergeant in the Army. And he did that for over 30 years. My stepdad spent 20 years in the Marine Corps. My mother was one of the first women that was allowed to go to Navy ROTC classes back in the 50s. And so I graduated from Quantico High School on a military base, so it wasn't really out of the ordinary to join the military and go fly. And so I joined Air Force ROTC and did 4 years of doing that, and there were women ahead of me, so I really didn't think, I never gave it much thought that the program hadn't been in existence for very long, because when you're 17, 18 years old, you don't think about that. It's there, you go do it. You don't ask, you know, what's the history or anything like that. You just go do it. There's no fear. And as it turns out, the two women that were in the junior class, one of them became a security police woman and the other one became a weather officer. They were always there. You know, you could always ask them questions and stuff like that. So they were there. The gal that was the sophomore ahead of me, she was going into personnel and admin, but I had always had my eyes set on going to pilot training.
What does it mean to you to be part of the first undergraduate pilot training class to include women?
I don't think we really set out to be the first. I think we just set out to be. It was just a goal that I had. And as things unfolded, I just happened to be in the right place at the right time. And had I not been in the first group, I think I would have continued to apply to get in one of the next classes. I probably would have done that until I was 27 years old and too old to do it after that. I don't think we set out to be the first, but we just happened to be in the right place at the right time.
Right. How did you learn about the opportunity?
I saw an article in the Air Force Times, and it stated that they were looking for, they had started a test group. They wanted a test group of 20 women, 18 active duty, one Air National Guard, and one Air Force Reserve. Now, in the mid-70s, after Vietnam, there was a drawdown. And so those of us that were graduating from ROTC in 76, we were given an option that if we didn't want to come on active duty, scholarships, money that we had received, that kind of stuff, we wouldn't have to pay that back and everything would be forgiven. So you could either join the reserves or you could just not come on to active duty, or you could accept your active duty assignment. At the time also, they were only allowing the distinguished graduates to go to pilot training. So even for the guys, it became one and done. I mean, there was only one guy that was going to get the pilot, go to pilot training. And ironically, in our class, the guy that was the distinguished graduate went to law school. So there went his slot. So whoever the next guy was didn't get it. And just really, really bad timing for some people. But for me, I saw it and I went and I immediately applied. There was an 800 number associated with the article. And so I called the number immediately. They told me that because I was not a second lieutenant yet, this was like in February or March of 76, that I could not be I would not be, I could not be selected because they were not going to take any second lieutenants in the test group, which crushed me. I mean, that absolutely crushed me right then and there. But then 1 week later, there was an article in the Air Force Times that said that the Air Force Reserves was looking for a woman. And I thought, I would rather fly airplanes in the Air Force Reserve than be a maintenance officer on active duty. So again, I immediately called the 800 number that was associated with that. And they started me on the process of filling out all the paperwork that I needed to fill out and get myself in a position to where I could meet the board.
So you were active duty and you went reserve just to go fly?
No, I was in ROTC.
Oh, okay.
I was still in college. I was still in ROTC. And I was going to come on to active duty as a maintenance officer. That was already in the works. That was, I wasn't going to go admin and personnel. I had taken the math requirements and all that in order to be able to go more technical. And so I was going to be going to maintenance school.
Okay. You must have been the youngest one in your class then, or of the women.
I was. Yep. And I graduated. I was commissioned. I had only been 21 years old by 3 weeks. There was one guy in my UPT class that was 1 day younger than me.
Okay. How do you feel about having your story featured in the National Museum of the U.S. Air Force?
Very humbled. Again, we just happened to be there. If it had not been me, there would have been another. So it's very humbling to have that honor to be in the museum. So I think I'm hoping that it'll be a good role model for anyone that comes by, that no matter who you are, no matter where you come from in life, the possibilities are endless.
When museum visitors see your exhibit, what do you hope they will learn from your experience?
Don't take no for an answer. Challenge yourself. There were many times that I was put in interesting situations. For example, we had this one mission and it would transit Nairobi for about a 10-day period. And the first time I came through, I had only been an aircraft commander for 90 days. As a matter of fact, I was getting a 17-day check ride because the flight examiner had never been there and wanted to go. And so his justification for going on the trip was to give me my 90-day check ride. So for 17 days, I was under the gun, making sure that I was making good decisions. But my first test when we got to Nairobi was I had to clear my crew through customs. And they would not accept that a woman was in command. And so I made the decision to take the bottom person on the list and say, okay, take the orders and get us through. And so the young staff sergeant took the orders and got us through customs. So there's some very interesting challenges, and you have to think on your feet. You have to be very flexible. Sometimes you have to not let your pride get in your way, but do things to make the situation work. I think we probably adapted to a lot of things, and the Air Force had to adapt to us when we were going through pilot training. Perseverance, flexibility, respect. Getting along with one another, compromise. I hope people can see that it doesn't matter what you look like, it's your abilities and your perseverance on getting a job done.
Before undergraduate pilot training opened to women, had you thought about becoming a pilot?
Oh yes, since I was 7 years old. Absolutely. You know, every time, you know, you look at an airplane, and I got to fly occasionally, and yes, absolutely. Yep.
You are an inspiration to many women who joined the Air Force and became pilots. What inspired you to break barriers and be part of the first class of undergraduate training to undergraduate pilot training to include women?
I kind of had some difficulties with this because I don't know, it's just always been in me since I was seven to look towards the skies. And I knew that I had to do well in math. I mean, I kind of had that in kind of in the background that I needed to do well in math. I needed to do well in school. I needed to be a little athletic. There were certain things that I felt that, you know, kind of went hand in hand with what you saw with the right stuff. Sadly, there weren't a lot of women role models at the time. So it was kind of hard. Plus the fact that from 1965 to 1969, I lived in Germany and I went to a German school. And the education system there's a lot different than our system. And women weren't quite as liberated and in starting to get into more technical fields than necessarily in America. It wasn't quite as accepting. It took a little longer over there. So for me, my education was fractured, and I didn't quite get the exposure, the TV exposure, like from the news, like what you see on television as to who's doing, you know, things. I really didn't know about the astronaut program that Wally Funk was part of, the ladies. I believe there were seven ladies that were in the astronaut program, and their program was canceled. I never knew about them until much, much later in life. I did vaguely know about the WASPs, but I hated history. I had a really bad history teacher, and I just hated history. So, I hated reading because I always had to study so hard. So trying to learn about a lot of that stuff, it was more, it had to be put in front of me on TV or in a newspaper article, and that was very few and far between. I think I didn't focus necessarily on gender. I focused more on capability, you know, on what people around me were doing, what was available, and I never really let gender become a barrier, even though it was there. I just always felt that I could get past that barrier for some reason. And again, I was right place, right time, luck, to where right when I came to that door came unlocked and opened just by pure luck.
Mm-hmm. Sadly, Susan Rogers passed away in 1992. How would you describe her?
We were in two separate sections. So Kathy LaSauce, Susan Chrisschott, Mary Donahue, and Vicki Crawford, they were in one half of the class. And Connie, Sandy, Mary, Carol, and I were in the other section. So we really didn't interact a whole lot because one was on early week, one was on late week. You really didn't mesh too much. I remember her as being quiet. I remember her as being a very competent pilot. I believe she came to pilot training already with a commercial and an instrument rating in 240 hours. And I just thought, wow, you know, how cool is that? And she was a flight nurse. I mean, just really a neat lady. But I always remember her as being very gentle. I remember her as always having a quiet smile on her face, having a good sense of humor, and yeah, that's what I remember about Susan.
Mm-hmm. How long did you serve in the Air Force, and what rank did you what rank were you when you retired?
Yeah, I was a colonel when I retired, and I served for 30 years and 19 days. So it was all in the reserves. Again, I had to make the decision not to come on active duty, but to go in the reserves because that was where my pilot training slot was. And I never regretted that. My thought process when I started pilot training was, okay, I'll serve my minimum in the reserves and then I'll petition to come on to active duty. What happened then is on a Friday night though, I met this young man in a bar at the officers club, and we started dating and we got married, and he was going to be on active duty. And as it turned out, I had more flexibility in the reserves. The reserve unit I was in was an associate reserve unit, so we were actually attached to an active duty wing. We didn't have our own airplanes, and we flew their missions. So I actually flew more than many of my active duty counterparts. As a matter of fact, I flew more than my husband did. But I only flew. I did have some additional duties, but I didn't have to do the additional duties like they do on active duty. I didn't have to move. I didn't have to reestablish myself every time that my husband got an assignment and we moved. I just stayed at McGuire. We made a conscious decision for me to do that. Financially, it wasn't very prudent. But in the long run, I didn't have to reprove myself like everybody else does when they go to a new base. You have to start over. You have to prove your worth. You have to do all that. I did not have to do that. I had 25 years at the same base with my same brothers and sisters in arms. And I think that that really helped me. And then after 25 years, I did not get squadron commander. I did not get promoted. And so I got a little bit of counsel and was given a phone number to call a gentleman at Scott Air Force Base to continue my career. And so I did that and then moved to Scott Air Force Base and stayed at that unit then for the next 5 years. So I didn't have a lot of the challenges that the active duty gals had. I got to stay in one place. I got to stay with one airplane. I didn't have to learn new airplanes. I could have had I chosen to go to other bases, but this brought stability to my family. And I thought that was good.
What were some of your most memorable assignments or missions? Are there any significant events from your career you'd like to share?
I've had some great trips. Probably the first interesting one was we were on a trip. We had what was called a 707 mission, and it was a 6-day mission. And basically, you flew an airplane all around Europe and then brought it home, and whatever was on board that airplane, vegetables, groceries, whatever, you would take from base to base and make sure that it got to where it needed to be. Well, we had just finished our 5 days of that mission, and the next day we were going to go home. And we showed up in Frankfurt at base operations just to do our normal flight planning and go home. And my aircraft commander, Major Phil Helpern, was called into one of the back offices. And so he went back there. And after about 20 minutes or so, he came back and he goes, Kathy, do you want to go to Zaire? And I was like, well, yeah. And he goes, get your bags, go out, get the bus, go out to the airplane and hide. I don't want them seeing you, because if they see you're a woman, they're going to take you off the trip. And since I was the only woman that was east of the Mississippi, they weren't looking at the flight orders to see if there was a woman on board or anything like that. There were going to be quite a few crews that were going to be flying a variety of these missions. We happened to be one of the first ones. And so I did as I was told. I got a crew bus and I got my bags and I put my bags on the airplane and I crawled up into the loft and I hid. And then he came back. And by that time we had to get some extra crew members to be an augmented crew. So we got another active duty co-pilot and another engineer and another loadmaster so that we would have extra complement to fly these long days. So then we went on our way, and on the way down to Liberia, we had the French Foreign Legion commander, a 2-star general, up in our cockpit, and he kept looking at me and he kept asking me for coffee. And I was like, no, I'm not doing coffee. I said, I'm here to teach you how to use the radios. I said, I'm the pilot. I don't do coffee. You got to talk to the loadmaster about that. So anyhow, so we ended up flying for about 6 days down in Zaire shuttle missions. And when they
when the Air Force found out, this was of course before cell phones or anything like that. When the Air Force found out I was down there, they weren't too happy because there were evacuations going on. I mean, the French Foreign Legion doesn't go in there just for a tea party. And so it was interesting. And we were actually awarded air medals after that, which would have been the first air medal given to a modern time Air Force female pilot. And so I had an air medal and a marksmanship ribbon. Those are the only two ribbons I had. So one like way up at the high and one like the most bottom ribbon you could possibly get. And people would ask me, where'd you get that? And I'd go, well, I thought it was one of the pretty ones at the clothing store. So I bought it, and which didn't go over too well with some people's sense of humor, but I thought it was kind of funny. But no, I'd actually earned it. So that was, and I just recently got his phone number. I'm sure he's in his early 80s, and I've always wanted to call him and ask him whether or not he got called into the commander's office when we got back and the door closed and said, what the hell were you thinking? You know, taking a woman, you know, into that. But he did ask me, I mean, and, you know, standing up for him and everything, he did ask me if I wanted to go, I'm so grateful that he gave me that opportunity, because it was like, I've been there. I've done that. It's look, we can do this. So I was really glad that I had that opportunity. Mm-hmm. The other mission I told you about already, the Mombasa mission. One day we ended up flying from Nairobi to Mombasa, to Diego Garcia, which is a little archipelago out in the Indian Ocean, down to Mauritius, which is a little island off of Madagascar, and then back to Mombasa. So everything's over water, which if anything happens, you're going for a swim. So it's from that aspect, it was interesting mission. We had to take an air conditioning part down to Mauritius because the air conditioning had failed on one of these ships. And it's probably the most interesting day that I've spent flying was doing that. And then the absolute beauty of Mauritius, just absolutely gorgeous. So that was another one. Some more downer missions. We flew an air evac mission back from Frankfurt to Andrews, and part of our cargo was a family of five in silver cases that had perished in a car accident. And so anytime you went downstairs to go to the bathroom or to go get some food or anything, you had to look at a 10-hour flight. You had to look at this family and see the ultimate sacrifice that, you know, that they had endured. Another one was coming back from Desert Storm, from Dahran back to either Frankfurt or Ramstein, we had 47 litters. So 47 wounded people in litters. And that makes an impression on you. You know, that the 141 had a unique mission of, you didn't know from one day or the next if you were gonna be carrying nuclear weapons or if you were gonna have a neonatal unit in the back with a brand new baby that you were trying to save. So you had such a dichotomy, you know, you have this whole range of missions that the 141 did that was amazing. Then another mission, we came back, we brought a burn victim back from one of the IED explosions. And they kept these two guys alive all the way across the ocean. And one of the guys started crashing, started going downhill on the way into Andrews. And we basically, you know, shoved the throttles all the way up and went as fast as we could go to get him to Andrews. He did make the transfer onto the aircraft going down to the burn unit, but sadly he didn't make it to the burn unit. So that's always one mission that has always stuck out in my mind. And another one was when I was the director of operations up at the TACC at Scott Air Force Base, where we coordinated for a neonatal heart and lung machine to be transferred from San Antonio up to Anchorage to bring a little baby back. And we had to coordinate the stabilization of the baby along with air crews. And we got three crews to stand by. And these guys said, you know, we'll violate every rule. Well, not every rule, we'll take every waiver that we can and do everything we can to get this baby, you know, and they made it. So, and the baby got to San Antonio in this, with this heart and lung machine and everything, and all, everything that had to go along with that. That was pretty neat. So those are some of the big ones that stick out in my mind. That, I mean, every day, you know, there was something new. There was a friend of mine, his parents, went space available on our airplane one time. And at the time, you were allowed to put them in the cockpit for takeoff and landing because we had 9 seats in the cockpit on the 141. And so his parents got to sit in the cockpit when I did takeoff and landing. And he said, oh, you know, they always talked about that and how neat that was, you know, to be able to do that. So that was pretty cool. So those are the missions that stand out to me, for me.
Why do you think it took so long for the Air Force to start training female pilots since WASP had proven women's ability during World War II?
I think society hadn't changed that much yet. And so when World War II was over, people went back to what was considered normal at the time. And women went back to their roles in the home. I listened to a WASP panel one time, and there was one feisty little lady at the end. And she said, I was a good Catholic girl. I had 6 kids. I stayed at home. I said, it was fun during the war, but you know, this is what she thought life held for her. And so she had her 6 children, and but she was just a feisty little woman. And you sit there and you go, you know, if maybe 10 years, you know, if things had been different 10 years, maybe she would have, you know, done some other things. But I think society tried to regroup and tried to go back to a normalcy. But then out of all of that, you still have a few people that'll stand up and let's take the next step. And I think it just took a while. It was kind of like, you also had the Tuskegee Airmen, you know, that proved themselves, the hurdles that they had to go through. Just kind of every minority group in society has had to kind of go through, you know, these hard steps. And I think, well, with the astronaut group, I mean, they did start in the early 60s. So that was, you know, even though the program was terminated, and when you think about it, the 60s, that was only a 15 years. I mean, when you think about 9/11 is already 19 years away. So it's really not that long of a time period. We just kind of think of it as a long time period because most of us weren't alive in World War II. So that's a long time. But in reality, World War II ended in 45 and we were in pilot training in 76. That's only one generation. That's 31 years. And actually, if you go back to the Navy, you know, it was 73. So it's really only 28 years. So when you think about it, yes, historically, you know, we look back and we think, oh, that was so long ago. But in reality, it really wasn't. And I think the time was right. The sexual revolution was going on. Just all kinds of feminism now, Cosmopolitan magazine. I mean, everything was kind of growing at that time. And I think it was the right time to do it. There were some women that did it before that. I don't know all their names, but you did have some people, well, some of the WASPs still flew. I mean, they still instructed and did their, and, you know, pursued their aviation careers. Granted, they didn't get too far at that time, but then Bonnie, I always say her name wrong. There was a lady at American Airlines that started. There was a lady at Frontier Airlines that started. And so they, you know, they were kind of a little bit before that, but not so much. But I think it takes a while. I mean, you try passing anything through Congress, it takes like forever, the studies they do and everything. And then, I mean, it just takes forever. So when you look at it as a 31-year period versus say, oh, it was so long ago, World War II, it's really not that bad.
Did you think pilot training was more difficult because of your gender?
I think that we were scrutinized more. I don't think the standards were any different, but I had a very good T-37 IP instructor. I had several really good ones. And then my T-38 instructor was very strict. So if you, like, let's say you went out and did a barrel roll and you did it outstanding, not just average, not just excellent, but you did it outstanding, to him, that was your new satisfactory now. And you always had to perform at that level. And if you didn't perform at that level, then you would get an unsatisfactory. And so it was very challenging for me to try to meet his standards. And it was interesting because he had gone on vacation for a week. And so I flew with five different other instructors. And I got excellence and outstandings from all of them. And they all kind of went, well, you don't fly so bad. And it was like, well, I don't think I fly so bad. You know, it was just that my grades weren't as good as the average because my instructor held my partner and I to a different standard. So it was interesting because one of the other ladies flew with my instructor the first flight in the morning in one particular airplane and came back, and he gave her an unsatisfactory because the airspeed was 5 knots off. He said she was 5 knots low during the approach. Well, I flew the same airplane with him a couple hours later, and he dinged me for the same thing. And then we figured out that the airspeed indicators were actually the problem, not our flying. But he didn't go back and go, oh, well, I'll change that grade. No, he didn't do that. And then the instructor went, the other gal went to the flight commander and said, I don't want to fly with him anymore. And it was like, oh, wait a minute, I have to go fly with him every day, you know? And you're going, I'm not going to fly with him because he gave me an unsat. And it's like, you know, welcome to the crowd here. So one of the things I thought was interesting was they were very worried about our upper body strength, and they wanted us to lift weights. Well, I'd been a power lifter in college, so to me, upper body strength was not an issue. And they had us going to the weight room 3 times a week, and we're like, we're having to do extra. You know, why don't you get the skinny, scrawny little guys that can't, you know, that we can beat up and make them go too? But they didn't apply that to the skinny guys, you know, to the guys that, you know, we could beat up. And then the other thing was, they determined that if you weighed underneath 140 pounds, you would have to carry a 40 pound seat pack out to the airplane and have it installed by maintenance. Otherwise the ejection seat would tumble. But they didn't make the guys that weighed less than 140 pounds carry it. And you just kind of sat there and kind of went, well, this isn't fair. You know, we had little black stripes, black electrical tape put on our name tag to annotate that the seat packs had to be taken out to the airplane. Finally, they got it to where we were complaining because you weigh 150 pounds, you're carrying a 40 pound chute. Now you want me to carry a 40 pound seat pack in 110 degree weather in a flight suit and a jacket. And are you crazy? And so some things came out, some changes came out really well, I think, from that, because then they started realizing that the little red wagons, they started letting the maintenance gals put their toolboxes in little red wagons and dragging them out to the airplane rather than carrying them. And then the men started going, well, she's dragging it. I'm hurting my back. And so it became, some of those things became very good things for change for everybody, because then back injury started going down when everybody started dragging it in the little red wagon. So there were some good changes that came out was it harder for us? I think because we were in the spotlight. No matter what happened, we were in the spotlight. So there was definitely added pressure when it came to that. The weight room, finally, after about 3 weeks, that got taken away. We didn't have to do that when they figured out that upper body strength really wasn't an issue. More technique than strength, especially with holding the brakes. Mary Livingston has a great story about that. I don't know if you've interviewed her yet on that, but she has a great story. So I think it was harder because there was extra pressure.
Did you feel your instructors were harder on the female students?
I think there were some guest instructors that definitely wanted to definitely harder, I think, on some of the women. I don't think as a whole, I think the Air Force did very well in selecting the instructors that we had. You're going to have all different kinds of instructors, and they're going to be harder on certain male personalities than another male personality. If somebody finds a weak spot, they're going to go after it. I don't think whether it's male or female. I really think they did a good job. The instructor I had, I'll never forget this. You may have heard this from other stories. The Air Force wanted to ground us during our periods. And the 10 of us got together and said, we're just not going to tell them. You know, we'll just not tell them when we're having our periods. And, you know, just leave it at that. Well, one day I went up and I was having a really bad day and I was having cramps and it was not a good day. And my instructor he's going, what's the matter with you? And I just yelled back at him and I said, you just ask your wife what's the matter with me today. And he went, oh. And he goes, would you like to incomplete the ride? And I said, yes, I would like to incomplete the ride. And that was that. We went back to the base. He goes, if you want to go back to the room, shower, freshen up, do whatever you want to, come back and debrief, we can wait. So I did that. I went back to the room. I showered. I came back. We debriefed. And the next day was another day. And so I thought that was very fair. And when you think about it, nowadays, now with the new FAR 117, there are days when we just don't feel well. You know, you don't have a good night's sleep. You might have a little cold coming on. There's times when maybe you should not fly. And this was probably one of those days that I should have said, I'm not in the right frame of mind to fly. And I think, and the whole flying industry has turned and changed. It's not a macho thing anymore. You're allowed to say you're not feeling well and not go fly. At the time, of course, that was not it. You know, you had to, you know, suck it up, buttercup, and on you went. But in that instance, I think it worked out. another funny story with that is I was going to fly a cross-country with my instructor. We were going to go fly to Point Magoo, a Navy base out on the coast of California. The problem is that you're going to be flying over water. So therefore, you have to, in addition to your parachute, you had to wear water wings. So not that I was endowed at all at the time. Many of us weren't. I had my parachute on, and then he was helping me with the water wings. But he didn't want to go there. He was trying to figure out how he was going to help me clasp it on my chest, because now my boobs were kind of getting shoved in between the parachute harness and the water wings harness, and he didn't know what to do. And it was, and you could tell he's only like 2 years older than me, and he's turning bright red, and I said, oh, for God's sake, just put the damn harness on. I said, you think I can really feel anything with all this crap on me? And so then he had a laugh, I had a laugh, and we went on with it. But it was situations like that, you don't know what to do until you actually are in that situation. And then I think a sense of humor kind of helps a little bit with that. And try not to take some things too personally when those things happen, because it's a learning experience for everybody. Like when they first fitted us for G suits, they didn't know, because our hip structure was different physiologically, if the G suits were actually going to work based on a woman physique versus a male physique. So those are all learning things that you sit there and nobody thought about the unintended consequences. You know, you show up and you go, oh my gosh, is that gonna work? And then you work with it. Like right now, they're making big strides with the urine, having to go to the bathroom in flight with the fighter pilots. And they're making good strides in aerospace physiology on this. And it's just, you know, we're getting to the point where we have to address the problem. So now let's do the best we can to fix the problem. And they're really coming around and doing a lot of good things on that.
Why were the female students required to attend pilot screening prior to starting class with their male peers?
Okay. In my situation, I had never flown an airplane before. And to go right to pilot training without having the T-41 instruction would have put me at a huge disadvantage. As it was a disadvantage already, because again, I had never flown. I didn't have the money to fly. I just had the aptitude. I had no idea what was going to happen. As a matter of fact, my first five flights, I threw up. And I had to have the Calori test done, where they pour ice water in your ear to see whether or not it's physiological or psychological. In my case, it was psychological, so I could continue. And I think it was to get us to know one another a little bit before we entered this process. What I always thought was kind of strange is that they put us together with an academy class, because these guys had never been to, in the last 4 years, they had only been with women socially. They had not been with women on an academic level or anything like that. So I thought putting us with an academy class was very awkward. But these 40 guys had known one another. They may not have been in the same squadron or anything like that, but they came from a brotherhood of academy graduates, and here they were. It gave us time to get to know one another a little bit better, to gel a little bit. To me, I kind of, when I was thinking about this question, I thought it's kind of like a sorority rush. You know, you're going to be going through a very high pressure year together, and maybe it's better that you get to know one another a little bit before you go on this journey. Plus the fact that I had to learn how to fly in 5 weeks. I mean, I had to go through the academics. I had to take my first flight. I had to do my first solo. I had to take my first check ride. Many of the women already had their private pilot's licenses or already a little bit of flying time. I had nothing. So for me, it was mandatory. And even nowadays, my daughter went through the University of Oklahoma, had her private, her commercial, and her instrument, and she still had to go through the flight screening program in Colorado before she went to pilot training. So it's not that it was unusual at the time. It just, it gave the Air Force a little bit of a head start on knowing where our flying skills were before we actually were really under the gun. So I didn't see it as a problem, because I needed it, because I needed to learn how to fly. So I thought it was a good idea. So that's my take on it.
So you said your daughter joined the Air Force?
Mm-hmm. And my son, the reserves. Yeah, they both went through pilot training. They both went to their respective reserve units, and now they both fly for American Airlines also.
Okay, what do they fly for the Air Force?
My daughter flies the C-5 up at Travis. My son was in the Grissom unit and he flew KC-135s. He's completed his commitment now. Mm-hmm. So he got out.
That's great. Do you think they joined because of you? And I guess your husband too.
Yeah. You know what? We never really pushed them, but my son saw Top Gun when he was 3 years old. And we consider it a huge success that he's an Air Force pilot, not a Navy pilot. But he's a comfort creature also. You know, when we told him that, you know, he wasn't always going to get to sleep, you know, in a hotel room or anything like that, you know, then he just kind of, he started thinking that maybe the Air Force was the way to go. And our daughter, we really weren't sure, you know, what she was planning on. She graduated high school a semester early. And she said, what am I going to do for this semester? And we said, well, you're going to go out to the local junior college and you're going to take some courses that are going to transfer to the big school at the cheap rates. And then we started talking to her and said, what do you think about taking intro to aviation, doing your ground school and just learning how to fly? I mean, it's no pressure. You're not under any pressure whatsoever. If you don't like it, you quit. If you like it, then it's 3 college credits and you learn how to fly and you had some fun. And after her second flight, she just went, this is it. And she's doing great things.
What aircraft did you fly during your career?
The T-41 there at Hondo in the flight screening program, a whopping 14.8 hours. Then 210.3 hours in the T-37 and the T-38 from pilot training. And then I have 6,543 hours in the C-141 in the A and B models. So I stayed with the same airplane until it retired. And then I moved on to the headquarters. Then I, in 1994, I went to work at TWA. And I was a 727 flight engineer for 3 years and an examiner and a line instructor. And then I went to the 757, 767. And then I also flew the MD-80. So for a total of about somewhere between 18 and 19,000 hours. So I haven't put everything in my online logbook yet. That's on my bucket list here in the next few years here in my retirement, to get that done.
If women had not been limited to the types of aircraft they could have flown, what would you have chosen?
Well, again, I didn't have a choice because I was in the reserves. And they said, as a matter of fact, this is how it went. I went through the selection process and then they called me up and they said, what aircraft would you like and where would you like to go? And I honestly had not given it any thought. And I thought, they also said that there were 2 alternates. And I thought, oh, if I make the wrong choice, maybe they'll take it away from me and give it to one of these other gals that said the right answer. And so I said, put me anywhere, put me in any airplane. And they said, okay, we're going to put you in the 141. And we're going to put you in the 335th Military Airlift Squadron at McGuire Air Force Base. And I went, great, that's super. And I got off the phone and I said to myself, what is a 141 and where is McGuire Air Force Base? But I thought, here I was willing to go anywhere on active duty in the Air Force. So what difference did it make where I was going to go? I was going to get to go fly jets. And that really, so it didn't matter. And the 141 was such a wonderful airplane. The unit that they put me in, the people were the most wonderful people. I mean, we still do Zoom meetings. We do now quarterly Zoom reunions. We have picnics and all that kind of stuff, and they're brothers. And we have a Facebook page, and we all, you know, get on Facebook page and complain and put pictures up from the past and what we did and how young we were and the guys, you know, when they still had hair. And we grieve, you know, when we lose a member, and we're happy when we see grandbabies being born. And that kind of thing. So I didn't have a choice because I was the only one in my class that already knew their assignment. And I'm glad that I got the 141 because I got to fly all over the world. I got to see places that I've been to over 100 countries. I've seen things, I've been to places, and it was really great. And none of the other airplanes probably would have given me that. You know, if I'd have been an instructor, I think that the T-38 and the T-37 would have gotten old after a while, and then I probably would have had to go to another airplane. The 141 was big. It was big. We had a big crew. We got to go to big places. So I'm really glad that I got the 141. No regrets.
If you'd been given the opportunity to fly a fighter aircraft, do you think you would have taken that?
At the time, yes. Yeah, had I been given the opportunity, I probably would have.
Was your status as one of the first Air Force female pilots well known throughout your career? And do you think it impacted your career or experience with the Air Force?
I got married right after co-pilot school, so my name changed. So the last name was not as recognizable as Rambo. Right. And so there were a lot of times that I would go to social events and everything like that, and I would be introduced as Mrs. Cosand, and you know, you would talk about your kids and what they're doing in school, and you didn't talk about flying, and it wasn't known. I remember sitting at the pool at Altus with my son on my lap. He had fallen asleep on the edge of the pool, and one of the ladies had come sat next to me, and she was very concerned about the women pilots that were coming to take her husband away from her. And I thought, oh my goodness, you know, I have a husband, I don't want yours. You don't have to worry about us. I mean, she obviously didn't know who I was, even though I was just sitting right there. There were many times where people just didn't know that I was a pilot. A lot of times my husband will, in the course of a conversation, mention, you know, that I fly too, which, you know, I'm very thankful, you know, to him, because he recognizes that, you know, that that's important to me. And a lot of times, you know, people, when I first upgraded, in the reserves, it takes a lot longer to make rank. It took 3 years to make first lieutenant. It took 7 years to make captain. So even though I was like 6 year first lieutenant and I had already over 3,300 hours of flying time, people would still always look past me and look to the major that would be my co-pilot and start talking to him. And it would be, he's not the decision maker. I am. You know, you need to be talking to me. I'm standing here at the window. He's standing behind me. A lot of people, no, I don't think being the first, because in the reserves, nobody really cared. I mean, they just wanted me to do well, just like any other pilot. They wanted the people that they're flying with, they wanted them to be safe. That was their main concern. There were times that public affairs, you know, would call me and go, hey, can you go up to Connecticut and go to talk to a junior ROTC unit up there? And so then, you know, I'd put my uniform on, I'd drive up and I'd, you know, talk for an hour in Connecticut, and wonder how come all the kids were going to UConn, which I thought, why is everybody going up to Canada? And then I realized it was the University of Connecticut. And so it was kind of interesting. I got asked one time to come down to Tinker and dedicate a woman's dormitory in honor of one of the fallen WASPs. And I was just a second lieutenant at the time. And that's when I had my air medal and my marksmanship ribbon. And a general came and asked me, he goes, where did you get that? And I told him about going to clothing sales. He didn't like that. And then I told him the real story, and then that was pretty cool. But I got asked to come to Tinker to give a speech, you know, for the dedication of this dormitory. And the old adage, know your audience, could have been very important to me at that time. I did all this research on on this particular WASP and was going to get up and tell the story about what the WASP did in World War II. And it turns out my audience is 200 WASPs. And I went, oh no. And so I stood up there and I just kind of went, okay, you know, we're dedicating this dormitory to Paula, and I don't remember her last name. And I told a little bit about that. I said, but to tell you about what you did, and that would just be wrong of me to be standing here to tell you your history. And I said, and so I went, okay, let me tell you what pilot training is like nowadays. And I just talked about the experiences that I had had flying a supersonic jet and going to co-pilot school and flying, you know, a heavy cargo airplane and some of the things that I had already done in my, you know, one little year that I'd been there. And it was kind of liberating in a way, but it was just kind of like, here I've got 200 WASPs and I can't tell them their story. I mean, that's kind of silly. You know, let's talk about some fun stuff. And then we did some Q&A and it went pretty well from there on. So that, you know, being one of the first, you know, helped, you know, in some of those instances.
Did becoming one of the first Air Force female pilots open any opportunities in your career?
No, I don't think so. Not in the reserves. As a matter of fact, I think it may have hindered it, you know, when I went up for squadron command, because I was more qualified than the other people, absolutely more qualified. I had done Air War College. I had done pretty much every job in the squadron, basically because I was a woman. I could type. I could type the OPRs. I could get them out on time because I didn't have to wait for the giving it to the secretary and have them type it. Of course, now with computers, everything's done, you know, fairly easily. But the fact that the vice wing, as a matter of fact, there were times when I had an ops group commander, at the time they called him operations officer, wing operations officer, tried to kick me out of the unit because my husband got an overseas assignment. And so he was getting very, he said, okay, if you live east of the Mississippi and move west of the Mississippi, you're out of the unit. If you live west of the Mississippi and you move further west of the Mississippi, you're out of the unit. And if you go overseas, you're out of the unit. And it's like, but I'm going overseas because of my husband's active duty assignment. It's not, I just feel like moving to Montana or anything like that, but he wouldn't have any part of it. But he was also a Southern boy. And so it was very difficult for him to, I think, make an objective decision on this. And he pulled me in, and I was battling this policy. And he says, well, I don't know how you and Bobby do it. And we had two children. And I said, it's none of your business how we do it. We do it. Why don't you let me try to figure out, you know, how to do it? Well, I ended up contacting my congressman and doing a lot of research and basically ending up getting a waiver to the new policy to where I could stay. And I went in and I said, give me 6 months. If I can't stay current, then I will voluntarily leave. Well, God has a wonderful sense of humor. And 28 days after we moved to Honduras, we got activated for Desert Storm. And so I obviously was back in the unit. I was there within 24 hours and I stood in front of the ops officer and I said, so we're so-and-so, so-and-so, and so-and-so because they work for Northwest. And they did not get there within the 72-hour mandatory report. And this was all stuff that I had brought up prior to this. And I made a point of standing in front of him and proving to him that I could be there within 24 hours. And later on, 3 months later, he came up to me and he apologized. And he stated, when people tell me, you know, ask to try to prove themselves from now on. I'm going to at least give them a chance. And I thought, yay. You know, there was a lot of sleepless nights with that, because I had worked hard for 14 years. And just because my husband has an overseas assignment to Central America, now all of a sudden I'm, you know, my career's at an end. And we got over that. So that was good. But that was probably one of the harder fights that I had to fight to keep my position.
How do you think your success impacted other women?
I think I've been able to, when you talk to people, they listen a little bit. I think they're more apt to listen. I had one lady that I talked to at the Women in Aviation Convention one time, and she had flown early in her married life, then had children, stayed at home, and had not gone back to flying. And I had spoken to her and I said, get back in it. You know, if you love doing it, get back in it. Well, 3 years later, I ran into her at Reno, and I didn't remember her because I talked to a lot of people. And she came up to me in uniform, in her pilot uniform, and she goes, look. And she said, you talked to me 3 years ago and told me to get back into it. And look, I got a job. I got back into it and I got a job. And she was beaming. She was absolutely beaming. And so you sit there, you know, you talk to little girls, you talk to young boys. I talked to anybody. We had interestingly enough, last year, I was flying with a flight attendant, and he was interested in joining the reserves and going to pilot training. And I said, why don't you do that? And he kind of looked at me and I said, you know, the gay ban's lifted. And he was shocked. He didn't know that. And I said, you know, don't make it part of your interview process. Be who you are, but don't let that be the forefront. That's part of your life. That's not necessary. If you want to be a pilot, you can go be a pilot. So I don't know where he's gone yet, whether or not he's actually pursuing it, but that was one thing. It's like no barriers. No, there are no barriers. It's the barriers. You set the barriers up yourself. You know, get over those, work hard, find every avenue, find out what boxes you have to check, find out what courses you need to take, find out what physical exam, you know, where to get your physical exam, get all those boxes checked, and you can be anything. You know, you can do anything. And that doesn't just apply to pilots or pilot training. That applies really to anywhere in life. You know, find your passion. You only go around once. Have a lot of fun doing it and just go do it.
Since you were involved in breaking the barrier for female Air Force pilots, did you break any other barriers during your career?
Well, the one mission, you know, going to Zaire, that was the first air medal awarded. My first pregnancy, I was grounded immediately. I didn't want to take the cholera shot. It was a live vaccine. I didn't want it to harm the fetus. And so I immediately became grounded. With that pregnancy, I had a C-section. Well, our reserve unit always does its physical the physical training in November. So that was only 6 weeks after I had my C-section, but I ran my mile and a half with the guys, which is the most stupid thing I have ever done in my life. Undoubtedly the most stupid thing. My second child, they had just opened up, just started allowing waivers for pregnant women, and no one had ever applied for a waiver before. And so I went to my flight surgeon. I said, so I want to keep flying. And he goes, why? And I said, am I sick? And he goes, well, no. And I said, then why can't I fly? And he goes, right answer. And so we did the paperwork and we got the first waiver to fly pregnant. And so I flew up to 24 weeks with my daughter. And then ironically, she flew up to 24 weeks with her son, her firstborn. So that was kind of neat. So those are kind of flying wise. Those are, to me, those are my two big firsts. Actually, I was the first woman to log 1,000 hours in the 141, first one to log 2,000 hours in the 141. Those are milestones that Lockheed acknowledges, and then they send you a little certificate. And then I'm the first woman pilot to log 5,000 hours in the 141. There was an engineer, Donna Wirtz, wonderful engineer. She's got more milestones than I in the 141, but she's an engineer. So it's a different category after the 2000. And then the only other thing is I was the first female Air Force reservist to be a senior controller at the Tactical Airlift Command Center. There was one lady, an active duty lady, that had held the position before me, but I was the first reservist, first female reservist. And after me, it's a 24-hour a day job. So they have 8 colonels that hold this position, and then you rotate. When this lady did it, she was the only woman out of 8. When I started, I was the only woman out of 8. By the time I left, 4 of the 8 were women. So I thought that was, you know, in a 3-year period, I thought that was quite an achievement for women, that we had actually gotten to a 50% ratio in a colonel position in a very high stress kind of command position. Because when you go to work, you're overseeing the entire airlift operation of all heavy airlift in the world. And so it's a neat job. It was a neat job. I'd go back and do it again.
What message would you like to give young women considering a career in the Air Force?
Go for it. Absolutely go for it. The sky is the limit, and now space is the limit. There are so many opportunities out there. There are so many things that will work for you. It is not going to be easy. There was one year in my life where I was a mom of 2, the wife of an ops group commander. I was an airline pilot. I was an Air Force Reserve pilot, and I did Air War College by seminar. I would never do that again, but it can be done. It can be done. You really have to prioritize. You have to take each day at a time, but there is no limit. There's really no limit. You can have children. You can have a family. You can be a single mom if you choose. There are no more restrictions as far as being a woman pilot that I know of. I just saw on Facebook where the first woman straight out of pilot training was awarded the F-35 just in the last day or two. And so every airplane out there, it's sitting there waiting for you. There are many people that will mentor you along the way. Women in aviation, women military aviators, there are great groups out there, the 99s, that will mentor you, encourage you, help you. We're all here. You know, we're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, we're on everywhere. You have a question, just contact us. We will help you a long way. There are scholarships. If you don't have the money to get your training, there are scholarships out there. There are ways to get you the training that you need to accomplish whatever dream you have.
We've gone through all of the questions, but is there anything else you'd like to share?
I want to thank you for the opportunity to do this. This is really kind of, it's very humbling. When I see the picture of us 10, and we do miss Susan. And when we got together down in Randolph earlier this year in June, and I got to fly the T-38 again, and got to go up with, you know, with 3 other ladies, it was such a dream come true. It was like, look at what we've done in 45 years. look what, how much more is out there to accomplish. I mean, NASA is talking about now, you know, putting a woman on Mars. I mean, those, I don't want to do that. I mean, I kind of like the Earth, but I know that there are some dreamers and some visionaries, and there are some people that are going chomping at the bit, like me going to pilot training. You know, they're chomping at the bit to go to Mars. And I think those things are wonderful. There are so many opportunities out there. If you want to be an engineer, if you want to be an aerospace physician, if you want to be a flight doc, you want to be a flight nurse, you want to be a flight engineer, a loadmaster, a boom operator, a drone pilot, a fighter pilot, a C-5 pilot, it's all out there. You have to decide that is what your goal is going to be. And don't take no for an answer, and go for it. And just go for it, apply yourself. And if you stumble and fall, get back up again. There are people that have fallen down many times, and you always have to get back up one more time, then you fall down, and you can keep going, and you can accomplish anything.